In this episode of the Ruth Institute podcast, we listen to Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, who is interviewed by Aaron Kunkel and Sarah Stone Street on their show, The Strong Women Podcast, sponsored by the Colson Center. Dr. Morse explains her upbringing, family history, and what the Ruth Institute is and its mission in the fight against the sexual revolution. She describes being the mother of two, one biological, the other by adoption, and having the ability to conduct informal, controlled experiments because of this difference. She talks of developmental milestones, such as playing peekaboo, that were experienced differently between her two children. All of these interactions taught her firmly that children need their parents. Dr. Morse explains that if a child misses a developmental window, it is a lot of work to go back later and try to fix. A child only has 1 year to be 1 year old, only 1 year to be 2 years old, etc. Her adopted son missed a lot of developmental interactions in his first 2 years of life, and Dr. Morse tells us of some of the things she and her husband did to make up for it. In addition, Dr. Morse comments on the secular culture today that has hollowed out the meaning of important Christian words like equality, freedom, and love, and has replaced them with new meanings. For instance, when St. Paul speaks of freedom, he means the, quote, ability to do what one ought, end quote. But by far, the most misunderstood word today is love. Far from being a mere feeling that one experiences with someone they like, Dr. Morse teaches that love, as conceived by great minds like St. Thomas Aquinas, is the pursuit of a greater good for the other, which points away from feelings to a concrete, objective decision. It is in the will and not the fleeting emotions. And love is very important for the family. Children need their parents to learn what love is. Dr. Morse shares some wise words on St. John Paul II's theology of the body and posits that women are the nurturers of life, and nurturing can take on many forms. She demonstrates this premise by sharing that she loves to cook for others and see them enjoy the food she makes. This does not necessarily entail raising a child, although mothers often cook for their children, but shows the beauty of womanhood and its many various forms of nurturing everyone. Finally, Dr. Morse shares what she considers a profound truth. Doing God's will is what makes us happy. She explains that this is in direct contradiction to the ideologue's ideas of equality. How? Listen to find out.
Dr. Morse is the founder of the Ruth Institute. And if you haven't heard of the Ruth Institute, we're going to talk about it a little bit. And I know you're going to be excited to learn about it if you haven't heard of it before. Dr. Morse is a PhD in economics. She's taught at Yale and George Mason University. And she's also written and co-authored 6 books, including the book we're going to talk a lot about today, which is Love and Economics. And she is a wife and a mother of 2 grown children, and she's also been a foster parent. And you were living in San Diego. I thought you were still living there, Dr. Morse, but you have moved to Louisiana. Is that right?
That's right. We moved to Lake Charles, Louisiana in 2015. So we no longer experience wildfires, but we do have the occasional hurricane. So,
yes.
But you haven't picked up the accent. I can tell that.
No, I guess not.
Okay, before we really jump into things, could you tell our listeners about the Ruth Institute and what kind of work you guys are involved in there?
So the Ruth Institute is an interfaith international coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. And the way we do that is to produce materials, including podcasts like this one, books, articles. We have our own video podcast called The Dr. J Show, which is where I interview people. We put on an annual event called the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution, which tries to bring together people who've been harmed in some way by the sexual revolution, together with people who have some expertise in various areas, together with activists. So that pretty much covers the whole realm of things that we try to deal with. We are not a therapeutic organization. We are not a lobbying organization. So there are certain things we don't do, but we think that we are a valuable resource for people to equip people so that they can understand what we're dealing with, so you can be more effective at whatever you're doing, whether it be pro-life work or pro-family work or trying to deal with sex ed in the schools or trying to deal with pornography or many of the other problems that face us. The Ruth Institute materials will help you make better sense of what you're dealing with and see that this is all one giant issue. It's not a bunch of little fragmented issues where everybody has to start from scratch figuring out what to do. It's really one giant issue. What is the place of human sexuality in our lives, and what does the church have to offer? And we maintain that traditional Christian sexual ethics have been correct from the beginning, and that we can prove it scientifically and historically. So that's in a nutshell what the Ruth Institute's all about.
I think you've done that a couple times.
A couple times? Done what, a couple times?
No, I think that you've been asked that question and had to answer it a couple times because you just had that down.
Yeah. It's true. I could go on all day. Do you want me to go on all day? I could go
no,
on
not
all
yet, day. Not yet. Not yet. We're going to come back to several of those things that you just talked about.
Yes.
So before we get to how you started the Ruth Institute, which I love that part of your story, can we start where you started, Dr. Morse, and just can you tell us a little bit about yourself, where you grew up, the kind of home you grew up in? Did you grow up in a Christian home? Those sorts of things.
I grew up in Ohio, Columbus, Ohio. I actually am a Buckeye. So if anybody's out there, I'm just going to say O-H and you all will know what to do. and I was the third of six children in a pretty traditional Catholic family. And I grew up in the 50s, 60s. I'm a baby boomer kind of person. And so when the sexual revolution hit, one of the things that it did to young people, particularly young women, was to convince us that we knew better than our parents and that we should throw all over that stuff and strike out on our own because, you know, they were dumb and we were smart. And which is a conceit, you know, it's a way of appealing to the vanity. And a lot of the modern ideologies do that in one way or the other, you know.
Yeah.
So anyway, I was married and divorced by the time I was 24. I had abandoned the church. You know, I had done all kinds of things I shouldn't have done, including have an abortion. And so then when I got remarried in a civil ceremony when I was teaching at Yale, it got to the point where we were ready to start a family. And I had it all planned out. Because by that time I had a doctorate, I was teaching at George Mason, I was on the tenure track, pretty sure to get it. And I thought, well, as soon as I get tenure, then I'll start a family. And I had it all worked out that I was going to have the baby in May. And then right after I had the baby, you know, take care of the baby during the summer and then go right back to work in the fall. And that was
perfect
the plan.
Scenario.
You know what? You know what, you guys, a lot of people did that. I mean, literally every woman faculty member I know had done something like that. And they had among them probably 10 children and none of them had ever missed a day of work. You know, that was like a point of pride to do it that way. So that's what I had in mind. And then, surprise, surprise, the baby did not come during the month that I had planned on. And so the result of that infertility crisis is that I ended up back in the practice of the Catholic faith and, you know, more or less on my knees and tears and everything, you know, coming back and had a really quite a profound reversion. I call it a reversion rather than a conversion, you know. And then, you know, there we were back, you know, I had to deal with the divorce and all of that. And then we started a family. Finally, we were able to start a family in 1991, in January of 1991. We got a call from an adoption agency saying, we have a little boy for you from Romania. And in 1991, if you remember your history, Berlin Wall had gone down. December of 1989 is when the Romanian people overthrew their government, and these Eastern European orphans were becoming available for adoption. So, you know, we were among the first people to do that, to adopt a Romanian orphan. And it was in January 1991, the adoption lady said, we have a little boy for you. He'll be 2.5 years old when you get him. What do you say? And we said, sure, why not? Because when you've been infertile for a long time, you don't really think a baby will ever actually come. So you go, sure, you know, it's going to be another disappointment, whatever, you know. And then 10 days later, I went to the doctor with a head cold and found out that I was pregnant. And so our second child arrived within 6 months of the first. We had two children in six months.
Word.
And they were 3 years apart in chronological age. And this really was the life-changing event. And not just because we were sleep-deprived and exhausted and everything, but because there's no way my doctorate in economics prepared me for those two kids. You know, nothing in my past really, you know, prepared me. And my husband is an engineer, so if anything, he was even less prepared for what we were dealing with.
He could build Legos, though.
Well, you know, he did a lot of inventive, very inventive and important things. His role was extremely important, but, you know, at the beginning, you know, we're like in shell shock.
Right. Sure.
But we very quickly realized that we had a controlled experiment going here in our household. And the experiment is, what difference does it make whether your kids have a mom and a dad? What difference do parents make in the life of the child? And of course, you know, I was like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. I mean, it matters so much, you know. And so over time, you know, while we're scrambling in place to try to deal with all the things we had to deal with, it just became clear to me as somebody trained in the social sciences that as a society, we're really, really missing the boat by saying that all we have to worry about is whether adults are happy with a child rearing arrangement. Mm-hmm. You know, that as long as the adults are happy, everything's going to be fine. That's simply not true, you know. And over time, it became more and more and more clear. And eventually, of course, I ended up leaving my job. You know, for 5 years, I was trying to do a full-time job on part-time hours, which is completely crazy. You know, they tell you, oh, academic life is so flexible. Yeah, not really. That's not really true. So eventually, we ended up moving to Silicon Valley. And my husband said, I've got a job. I'm getting out of here. We're getting out of DC. And I'm like, great, get me out of here, you know. And that was 1996. And I personally have never looked back to academic life. It turned out to be the best thing possible on many, many levels that I would never have predicted.
I wanted to back up just a little bit because you kind of alluded to this, but I know what you're alluding to because I read your book, but I want to make sure our listeners know what you're talking about. So you said here you've got a 2.5-year-old that you've adopted and then a biological child that within 6 months, now all of a sudden you've got a house full, and you said it's basically an experiment. And then you talk a lot about this in your book about how we cannot even bullet point the things that parents bring to their child in those infant years. So, and it's an experiment because you saw what was lacking in this adopted child, not in the adoption. But so to just maybe flesh that out just a tiny bit.
Oh, sure. And thank you for picking up on that, because I think that what you just said is important on multiple levels, you know. But the way we saw it, the way we became aware of it, is that, you know, our little girl was just kind of developing along normally, you know, because of our son and his needs, I was home a lot more than I would have been. But because we had to be there for Nick, I was home more with her. And so, and my husband was more engaged, you know, all of that was happening. And you could see how she was developing. You could see what normal development looked like. And then at the same time, we had speech therapists and physical therapists and occupational therapists and all these people buzzing around trying to help, you know, which was great that we had that. We needed that. We desperately needed that. And they were instructing us what to do for our 3-year-old that our daughter was just kind of flowing into automatically. And so I'll give you just one really dramatic example. If you're a parent or even a big sister or a big brother, you'll know what I'm about. You'll get this. We were told by one of the speech therapists that peekaboo is an important developmental task. That for a child to play peekaboo, it means that they are looking for something, they can anticipate something, and it's fun when you pull that little towel off their face or your face or whoever's hiding behind the towel. And so, we thought, oh, okay, we're going to play peekaboo, you know. So my husband, you know, throws a little diaper over our daughter's face and she laughs and, you know, it's just like peekaboo is supposed to be. So we tried this with our boy who is now, you know, 3 years old. And he was scared. Mm-hmm. He couldn't play peekaboo. We had to teach him to play peekaboo. You know, we had to kind of, you know, for her, it just kind of flowed automatically. And for him, we had to like install a subroutine. You know, we had to make it happen. And there were lots of little things like that where you realize, whoa, there is so much going on in these day-to-day interactions that we just blow right by it. We take it for granted, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's one instance of it. But the larger point that you drew up there is that social scientists, you know, which of course I was immersed in social science will have a whole list of activities that parents do. And they'll go down the, how many times did you change the diaper and how much time did you spend with the baby? And, you know, all these activities that you do. And so people are filling out the time forms and everything, you know, and the social science guys are drawing all kinds of conclusions about this, you know. And I'm sitting there thinking, you know, the amount of time that you spend with your child where you're in the room and you're doing nothing but taking care of the child, that's a subset of the way you're actually spending time with your child, right? Because you're over there cooking dinner and your child's on the other side of the room and the baby's going, blah, blah, and you go, you know, and you're having a little conversation with that little person, you know, you're engaging them and they learn to respond and they're listening and they're looking at you and you're looking at them. And, you know, but if you checked off the box on the little form, you'd say, I'm cooking dinner.
Right. I'm not imitating. It's just I'm cooking right. dinner.
Right, 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 right.
Well, so yeah, and I'm not connecting. You would think, well, I'm not connecting with my child, and because you're focused on the task and checking right. the box, like you said.
Right, right, right. Or you're in the supermarket and you have your baby mm-hmm. on your hip, right? How many times have you seen this? Okay, you're in the supermarket. You've got the baby on the hip, and you're rocking back and forth. You know, right? You're shifting your weight back and forth. You're rocking the baby, and you may be unloading the groceries or loading the groceries. You're doing all sorts of other stuff, but you're rocking the baby while you're standing there. Well, it turns out rocking the baby develops the neurological system, and it prepares children for speech. Well, I didn't know that. You know, nobody. You know, normal people don't know that, but you do it routinely. You know, and automatically, and the fact, you know, it adds up, but it adds up in some kind of organic way where the whole is more than the sum of the parts. So that kind of stuff, you know, just seeing that kind of stuff, it made me realize how sterile a lot of social science really is. You know what I mean? You know, it's yeah. like there's stuff built into the questions themselves that's somehow not quite right. You know,
yeah, and I love that about your book. And the first time I read your book, Dr. Morse, was in 2006, so it's been a while. But at that point, I have 5 kids, but at that point, they were all little. And you wouldn't pick up a book called Love and Economics and think, now I should give this to all the parents of young children as an encouragement. But boy, was it an encouragement, because you go into detail so much in the book of all that we do as parents to create trust and these bonds of trust and love with our babies. That, and you mentioned in the book how, you know, at the end of the day, especially when you have little ones, you think, well, I've done nothing today right. because I just changed diapers and did laundry and cleaned up throw up and you know, whatever. And even as a person, just reflecting back on all that our parents did and thinking about how this maybe shaped how we were and how we were able to trust people or not to trust people. And it's such a great part of your book. And if you are listening and you have young kids, you need to read this book just to open your eyes to all that's happening in these mundane tasks that we do as parents. And yeah, the perspective you had that really God showed you through your son and your daughter is so incredible, and a perspective most of us don't get to have because we just, you know, go along and we're not given 2 children like you were at the same right. time, different stages, different backgrounds. So I love that part of your book, just how important it is, all these mundane things that we do as parents with our children and what that builds in them is so neat.
Well, I'm really glad that it was helpful to you, really, because yeah. I wrote it partly for that reason, you know, because I thought young mothers should realize how important this really is, because we're still, back then and even today, we're still barraged with all this stuff that you're wasting your time. If you're staying home with children, your brain's going to mush, they'll be fine in the daycare, blah, 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 blah. You know, we're still bombarded with all this stuff. And
it's even more assumed now, because it's now a couple generations yeah. deep.
Yeah, and you have to make an excuse for yourself or an account of yourself somehow, you know. And so partly I wrote it for that person, but I also wrote it for the people in economics, my colleagues in economics, to try to steer them off of this stuff and say, you know, come on, the choice of the parents is not the only thing that's at stake here. You know, children have a developmental timetable that is pretty much hardwired into them. They only get 1 year to be 1 year old. You know, they only get 1 year to be a 2 year old. And when that window's gone, it's a lot of work to go back and try to deal with what they missed out on. It's much easier to get it done when it's designed to be done, you know? So I'm so glad to hear that it was helpful to you, because the economists weren't listening whatsoever. So it was great that the moms are listening.
Yeah, somebody's listening. Okay, I have a question, though, that you just talked about in that whole story. Part of the feminist movement and the devaluing of staying at home and taking care of your family is like you said, you know, you're wasting your time, you're wasting your degree. Did you get that pushback? Because you are a doctor. Like, was that a hard choice for you too? I would think it would be, I mean, sometimes we don't even realize how much we wrap our identity up into what we do or how we perform. And then to go from this really respected, you know, you get affirmation for your thoughts to staying at home where everybody's like, feed me, you know.
They are grateful when you feed them. You must admit,
But they are also, they also let you know how much they don't like this meal or they don't like that meal. I always say,
They're very honest.
That's a better, more optimistic way of seeing things. I always say, once you can pay for your own food and pay for all of us and cook for all of us, then you get to be picky. But until then, this is what you're having for dinner. But anyway, so tell us about that transition. I mean,
well, you know, it was hard. I'm not going to lie. It was hard. I mean, but I had a number of blessings along the way. One is that when you've been infertile for a long time, you don't take motherhood for granted. So therefore, I was ready to do that. Also, by that time, I had been pretty far along on my spiritual journey. If I had done this adoption without that, without a prayer life, without the connection with the sacraments and with the church and stuff, I would have been a mess. You know, I would have collapsed. Yeah, I can't even imagine how people do that. So I had that going for me. So then when the kids came and we had this very special situation, I was willing to enter into doing what needed to be done. But it was still hard. Mm-hmm. You know, it was hard to, because I still had this vision that, oh, we'll put them in daycare. Well, our son flunked out of daycare. This is now our family joke that this is how we tell it to him. Now, he's 32 and he's fine, you know, but that's our, now we laugh about it, you know, you flunked daycare, kiddo, you know. But so then my next move, well, I'll get a nanny. That'll be my next move, you know. So I'm trying to do this. And in the meantime, I'm getting pushback from some of my colleagues. Not all, but some of my colleagues. Yeah. So when my husband came up with the idea of moving to Silicon Valley and, you know, getting involved on the .com roller coaster and stuff, I'm like, okay, I'm ready. Fine. You know, let me have a clean break rather than trying to negotiate that boundary all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, let's have a clean break. Get me out of here. And then when I went over there, I made it up in my mind, you know, that I'm going to go to the Hoover Institution at Stanford, which is right nearby, Silicon Valley. And I know a few people over there. I'm going to go and propose that I have a part-time, you know, some kind of part-time research gig with them or something like that. And if I don't get it, I don't get it. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to just let it go, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I did that, and the then president of the Hoover Institution said, well, this is the easiest interview I've ever had, you know, we'll take you on quarter time, give you a quarter time salary, and that'll be great, you know. And I'm like, this is a better job than I left, you know, this is great, you know. And so I wrote Love and Economics while I was at Hoover, you know. Uh-huh. So the kids would go to school, and I would sit down and get, you know, write and do whatever else I had to do professionally. And when they came home, that was that.
You know, I have to just draw out something here that is a theme in a lot of our interviews, is that your giftings never really changed. Mm-hmm. And I love this part of your story because it's almost like your giftings grew through you stepping aside and observing with your children and learning with your children and all this stuff. It's like it never went away is what I'm trying to say. But God used your life experience and he used those different things to actually place you in a different spot. But your giftings were still being cultivated and all that. And we see that with, don't we, Erin? We see that in a lot of our interviews. But I think that's so beautiful how God does that. And let me just go a little bit further and say, when young women ask me about, you know, should I pursue college if what I really want to do is get married and have babies? And I say, education and learning is never wasted. So right. Do the next good thing in front of you, the opportunities that God's placed in front of you, and you will be shocked at what he does with it. It probably will look nothing like what you set out to do, which is probably, you could testify to that, right?
No kidding.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what I especially, I 100% endorse what you just said. I mean, I think that's very true. And I think that's the life of discipleship. And so you can look at that in a theological manner and say, okay, God created each and every person with a unique mission and a unique calling. Each and every one of us images God in some unique way. And because God is infinite, nobody's going to image him perfectly, obviously, you know, but we're all going to image some aspect of the divine in what we do. And so God has put each one of us here for a particular mission. The more you pursue that mission, the better off you're going to be, the happier you're going to be, the more integrated you're going to feel. And of course, the more pleasing you are to God. That's what God wants you to do. Okay, next. Go here, go here, go here. You know, I've ended up all kind of places I didn't expect. But the other thing I want to say about that is that that is in direct opposition to the idea of equality, that we should all be equal to somebody. And if you think about it, equality means you're always looking at someone else. You're always looking next to you. Mm-hmm. Like, am I as good as him? Am I as good as her? Oh, he's got more than I do, so now I'm mad. You know, or he has less than me, so he's less than, and I can look down on him. You know, I mean, equality has a lot of toxic stuff wrapped up in it, honestly, you know. Yeah, I mean, there's a proper Christian understanding of equality. There's a proper role for equality, but the way our society has kind of absolutized it and really idolized it, it's inhuman, actually. And you're much better off being unique rather than being equal. I think you're just going to be much happier both inside your marriage and inside your life generally. And yeah, I think it's a really profound point. And I'm glad. What are some of the other ways you're seeing that in other women in your other interviews that you do?
Yeah, I think just how their journeys have brought them to places they had no idea they would be, but how God used their giftings, their training, their education. And the outcome a lot of times wasn't exactly what they thought that outcome would be.
Like Cheryl Batchelder.
Mm-hmm.
She was the CEO for Popeye's Chicken. And she talked a lot about this gifting and this calling kind of language with us a while back. And she, but just her life, you know, she could look back on it and go, oh, okay, I see how that was all ordered towards this. But it was just still my giftings that were playing out in the opportunities set in front of me.
Right. Yeah, and Reggie Littlejohn, I don't know if you know who she is.
I sure do.
Morse. Yes, I figured you did. And just, you know, she's this attorney, this high-powered attorney, and then she gets sick. And God uses this sickness to make her aware of, actually, well, she met a client from China who had had a forced abortion. And anyways, God uses all these things. And then now she's started this organization, and she never, ever would have thought her law school, her growing up as a child, how her parents advocated for people, you know, all these things, and how it led to this life she never thought she would have. But God used all of it to make the impact that he's having through all that she did. Even, and the cool thing is, the older we get too, we realize he uses our mistakes and the things that we aren't proud of, but he uses those too, because it's part of our shaping and our growing as our struggles, you know. So, but you mentioned equality, and I think that's a good segment into, we wanted to definitely get your insights and wisdom into the feminist movement, the sexual revolution, and how these ideas are still impacting us so much today. And particularly in the book, I love that you really focused on the word love and what it actually means. Yeah, maybe we could go there first, but you use in the book Thomas Aquinas' definition that to love is to will and to do the good of another.
Yes.
And that is such a different definition than definitely the sexual revolution, and still today, as it's more, these ideas have morphed and changed a little bit, but still, to will and want someone's good is not how our culture sees love. Our culture sees love as doing, letting the person do whatever they want, letting the person be whoever they want. So you can unpack that better than we, but what do you think about how the sexual revolution shaped our idea of love?
Yes, I think one thing that you can see with the whole modern period is to take these words that had valid and beautiful Christian meanings, hollow out that meaning and replace it with something else. So that the word, like the word equality, doesn't mean anything today like what it would have meant in the Middle Ages or to St. Augustine or something, you know, or to St. Paul. It doesn't mean anything like that. And same with freedom. That's another big example. You know, St. Paul meant freedom means to do what one ought to do, you know, and to be a slave is to be a slave to sin. But love is, I thought it was important to talk about love and what it really means, because with respect to yourself, we think that love means that I like the way I feel when I'm with you. I'm in love with you means that I like the way I feel when I'm with you. And if I don't like those feelings anymore, then we've fallen out of love and I'm justified in walking away from the relationship. See, there's no sense of giving or self-giving or self-sacrifice. There's, you know, the cross is a complete scandal in that environment, right? No one can understand the kind of self-sacrificial love that Jesus did. So there's that side of it. And then there's the other side of it as a parent or a person with responsibility for others. How do we show our love to somebody that we're responsible for? Well, we just let them do whatever they feel like. You know, we keep them happy. If they like the way they feel, then we love them, you know. But that isn't really true, because we know as adults that there are certain things that our child needs. We know as a teacher, there are certain things the students need, you know, and they don't always like it, but too bad, you know, you have to do, because you're trying to pursue some greater good than their immediate feeling. So that definition of love, what I like about it is that it points away from feelings and it points towards objective good, you know, and it points away from involuntary, spontaneous feeling and towards a decision. You know, it's a decision of the will. To love is not a feeling. To love is to do, you know. And so that's what I think needs to be recovered. You really can't be a good parent if everything's all about feelings all the time. You know, you'll either end up being negligent toward the child or narcissistic about yourself, you know, or some combination of those kind of things. And so that has just lots and lots of negative spillover effects to misunderstand the word love, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you can't be a good parent. You can't be a good child to your parent. You can't be a good worker for your employer. You can't be a good member of your church if the focus of love is just simply your own feelings. And this is where, yeah, you see how these ideas from the culture have seeped into the church, don't you think, Dr. Morris?
No question about it. Because the churches are trying to compete with the world, you know, and trying to gratify people. And actually, that's not what people need, you know. And we see this on the Catholic side. I suppose you see it on the evangelical side, too, that the churches that are indulgent actually are not the churches that are growing. Mm-hmm. The churches that are growing are the churches that provide structure and teach the full gospel truth, you could say, and that make demands on people, you know, especially men. Men like the challenge. Men don't like to be coddled. You wouldn't know that to look at popular culture, because, you know, we're so used to talking about men being toxic and all of that. But the fact is that masculinity, part of being a man is to have a sense of the heroic and to long to be heroic and to want to protect others, you know, to want to sacrifice themselves for the good of the community. That's part of being a man. And so if you never challenge a guy, they don't really like that. You know, they may give you some pushback, but they don't mind being pushed back. They want to see you stand up for what you think, you know, and that's how they treat each other. And a lot of times women look at that and think, oh, that's all toxic. Look at them, you know, but no, it could be, but it needn't be, you know, that kind of making demands on one another, holding one another accountable. that's manhood as it ought to be, you know?
Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that explanation of masculinity because it's so dignifying to what masculinity really is in the true sense, in the good sense.
Right, right.
And we're a strong women podcast, so people might get the impression we're against masculinity, but we are not. We are for it. And so on the flip side, though, you know, femininity, and we think that has been so, the words have been hijacked in the yep. culture and changed. And so how do you see femininity too in the true sense of what that looks like?
On the Catholic side, we have this whole thing now called the theology of the body.
Yes.
Which I don't know if you've ever heard.
Yes, we just talked to Christopher West.
No way.
Last, yeah. Well, super. Let's see. His episode will air right before yours.
What?
Oh,
so that's super.
Our listeners super. Will know exactly what you're talking
about. Well, that's great.
Yes.
No, that's really great. Because see, Pope John Paul, when he was a philosophy professor and a parish priest, basically, you know, he was noticing young couples in Poland, you know, having all these marital struggles and, you know, just trying to love each other with all of the pressures of modernity and plus communism, plus all the other things they had to deal with. And that was then. They didn't have transgender TV characters in Poland when John Paul right. was trying to help them out. But he tried to think to himself, well, what is it that we're positively for? You know, the church has all these things that we're against. So if you're against something, you're for its opposite. So he tried to articulate, what is it we're positively for? And one of the things he came up with is that we're in favor of lifelong, self-giving, marital love. That's what we're in favor of. And all the things we're saying no to are negations of that. So if you're having sex with someone you're not married to, you're not really it's not really life-giving. It's not really self-giving. There's a selfishness involved. There's a way that you're using each other, you know. And so that's what he was trying to expound. Well, in the process of doing that, he thought a lot about male and female. And just ask ourselves, you know, why did God make us male and female? What is God trying to say to us? You know, I mean, he invented this stuff, right? It's not like, so he was trying to say something. So if you look at it that way, and you look at the female as the essence of being female is to nurture love, is to be the object of love, but also to be the nurturer of love and to be the nurturer of life, to bring within the self another person's life and give life to that person. So in that sense, you could say that every woman is called to spiritual motherhood. This is something I wish I knew when I was going through infertility. Every woman is called to spiritual motherhood, which allows us to nurture the life of others, you know, to bring them inside of ourselves, at least in our within our realm of concern, if not within our bodies, right? To bring them within our hearts and to nourish them, whether it be physically or psychologically or spiritually or whatever it is. Every woman can do that. And we feel great satisfaction when we do that. Mm-hmm. And we're not even allowed to admit that as modern women. You know, it took me a long time. I was in my 50s before I realized how much visceral pleasure I got from feeding people, from putting a meal on the table and see people enjoying the food, you know. And it was only because a friend of mine said, oh, my wife, she just loves feeding people. She takes such joy in it. And I'm like, I do too. What? Why did I ever notice that before? You know, and when you think about it, it's kind of crazy that we aren't allowed to notice how much we enjoy these life-giving things that we do. Well, what are we supposed to be doing if we're not giving life? What could be better, you know, really?
Right.
And in that framework and that understanding, the role of the man, of the father, is to sacrifice to protect the life which he has contributed to creating, you know, that we have co-created with God, husband and wife. But the role of the father is to protect the creation, you know. So there are parallels with the divine and the material and all kinds of different parallels that you could go into. It's really a very deep subject, but it's nothing to be afraid of. I mean, I think what feminism has done to us is to spook us into thinking that anytime we say there's a difference between men and women, we've said something heretical and terrible and unequal, you know. And that's the one thing we have to get over. I would just encourage everyone, even if you don't buy my particular interpretation or Christopher West or whatever, just stop being spooked over the idea that men and women are different. You know, come on, it'll be okay.
And to live in a time where you have to be courageous to even say that actually now.
Yes.
You have to have a little bit of courage to say, no, actually, there's men and women are different and it's good.
And it's good. It's all good. Yeah. It's really good. It's really good.
Because I love that picture of women as nurturers of life, because that's so broad. I mean, that can start when you're a teenager. It actually can start for a little girl, just thinking about a nurturer of life. And and then our whole lives, we can be that in different ways. So
that's right. That's right. But it's important to say that it can take so many forms, you know, that life-giving and nurturing can take so many different forms. And it means that if you're going to be a teacher, you can be a teacher in a different way. If you're going to be an attorney, you can be an attorney in a different way. If you're going to be a police officer, law enforcement officer, you can do it in a different way, you know. And to ask all of us to be identical with each other is to diminish everybody. You know, it diminishes the man, it diminishes the woman. Yeah. It also, I think, needs to be said that there are lots of ways to be a woman. There are lots of ways to be a man. This takes us into the whole transgender issue that people get it in their minds, well, you know, I don't like to play football, so maybe I'm really a girl. Or, you know, I like these stereotypical boy things, so maybe I'm really a boy. You know, that too is a kind of corruption of the idea of individuality, you know, that you're not born in the wrong body. Nobody's born in the wrong body. Everybody's born in exactly the right body that God wanted you to have. And God gave you a male body, God gave you a female body. That's who you are, you know. And nobody's born in the wrong body. And if you like things that are outside gender stereotypes, that's perfectly okay. There are lots of ways to be a boy or lots of ways to be a girl. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to be prepared to say that because, of course, there's a lot of pushback on that. The body is really a conflicted thing right now. You know, it's like people are simultaneously overindulging the body and at the same time afraid of the body. You know, they want to believe that we're so above it that we can remake ourselves without reference to the body's in our way. You know, this pesky sex thing that keeps making babies. I want the sex thing without the babies. I want the babies to not really be dependent. You know, it's like we're rewriting our relationship to the body on a regular basis. That's not working for us.
Mm-mm. And, you know, Christopher West gave a really good definition of what's happening is we're trying to take the body and the soul and separate them, which is the definition of death.
Yeah,
when
right.
Our bodies and souls are separated. Yeah. We're dead. And so he's talking about a culture that tries to separate the body and the soul leads towards death. So I just thought that was a good tie-in with that because since he just was on last week. So before we get to the ending questions, I just want to take a minute to talk about something you talked about probably in the first 5 minutes, but I want to come back to it. You said survivors of the sexual revolution. And then you just kept going. Oh. Tell us, which I've looked at your list, so I know, but our listeners are probably like, yes, survivors of the sexual revolution. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. So we started thinking about how to combat some of these problems that we're seeing in the world, how to combat the attacks on marriage. The Ruth Institute has been very involved in the whole defense of marriage area and defending the definition of marriage as being one man and one woman. And it finally became clear that the reason gay marriage made sense to people is because we've already allowed the definition of marriage to deteriorate so badly that people think it's just about two adults and how they feel. And so we were starting from way, way behind if people already have that in their mind. So you think, well, if we're doing it wrong, if we're not doing it the way God wants us to be doing it, it's got to be that people are suffering as a result of that. It's the opposite of what we said at the beginning, Aaron, you know, about people doing what God wants and you feel better and it works better. If you do what God doesn't want, He doesn't have to go out and punish you. Nature will punish you. You know, nature will take its own, will, you know, exact its own penalty. So we started thinking about that and just started listing off different ways in which people violate the natural law and what kinds of things happen to them. Came up with a big long list of various ways that people suffer, most of which have nothing to do with homosexuality, although that has its own list of problems too. But right at the top of the list, we would put the children of divorce and the abandoned spouses, the people who want to stay married, but their spouse wants to stay married. And there's no, you know, in our culture, under no-fault divorce, the government doesn't even ask, if one person wants to divorce, that's the end of the marriage, which is completely unjust. And, you know, there's nothing about love. There's nothing loving about that, nothing just about that. And there's tremendous suffering just from divorce. And then you look at people who were never married in the first place. And so the child is generally would generally be separated from their father to some extent. It's unusual if your parents aren't married when you're born. It's unusual to have a lifelong, close, daily relationship with your father throughout your childhood. That would not be normal. Be usual for your mom to have another relationship with another guy. And while she's with that guy, she's more interested in that guy and the kids they have together than they are in you, the first child, the child from the leftover relationship, you know? So we started just thinking about and cataloging some of the suffering that people endure and trying to just really pay attention to that. So we've written about those issues that I just mentioned, family breakdown. Also, I would say that the whole phenomenon of post-abortive women is also a kind of survivor of the sexual revolution, which the pro-life movement has been onto that for quite a while, you know, to say that abortion didn't solve all the problems it was supposed to solve. It caused a whole bunch more problems than no one wants to talk about. And, you know, if we're going to give people choices, we better give them full information so they can see the downside as well as the upside. You know, this is the other part of that process. So that's an aspect of it. People who have medical problems as a result of participating in the hookup culture, maybe, or from their use of contraception, sometimes abortion can have medical fallout. Then there are people who regret being involved in the hookup culture, people who regret being involved in the LGBT lifestyle and who want to get away from it. We call them refugees, you know, refugees from the hookup culture. And nobody wants to talk about that. And you're probably aware, refugees from the LGBT subculture, they don't exist. The ex-gays, they're not real. You know, they don't get a voice. We don't want to hear what they have to say, you know. Even though there are lots of people who walk away from it and don't want to have anything to do with it, they have, you know, they might still have some feelings, but they know they're better off dealing with their issues without being full-on participants in the LGBT subculture. And they're not allowed to exist culturally, you know, socially. So we try to call attention to these various aspects. People who have been harmed, people who have pulled themselves together. We try to help people pull themselves together. We're like I said, we're not a therapeutic organization, but we do try to provide information and resources so that people don't feel so alone, so that people might know where to turn. And then finally, we've gotten recently, in the last couple of years, we've gotten involved in survivors of childhood sexual abuse. Mm. We got involved in that because of being Catholic and having to confront the clergy sexual abuse in the Catholic Church. When the whole Theodore McCarrick scandal hit, we felt that we had to get involved in that. So we've done some important statistical work on that, just kind of analyzing, well, what was this all about? What is it all about? Is it better? Is it worse? Is it still going on? What's going on? You know, so that's led us into a whole series of other places that we never expected to go. Like you said, Erin, you know, I never expected to be thinking about that. But here we are with probably the most widely cited study on clergy sexual abuse within the Catholic Church. It was published by the Ruth Institute, not by me personally, but by one of my colleagues, our house sociologist that we have, Father Paul Sullins. So that's what I mean when we talk about the victims and survivors of the sexual revolution. That's what we're talking about.
And you just listed off a ton of things. And I know without a shadow of a doubt that our listeners are like, ooh, that's me. Oh, that's yep. me. That's me. Maybe multiple mm-hmm. ones are me.
Yep.
And so I would just point you listeners to the Ruth Institute and dig a little bit. It's easy to find the list of sexual revolution survivors, and you can dig a little bit and find the resources and that, you know, maybe can start you on the healing process, get you thinking about it, talking about it, praying about it.
So you can find all this material at ruthinstitute.org. Tons and tons of free material, articles, podcast series, audio podcast series like this one. And also we have a video podcast, which is my interview series where I do an in-depth interview every week with somebody who has some expertise in one of these areas. Mm-hmm. But so there's lots and lots of resources, and you'll be really encouraged and you'll become better informed and have things to share with people and all that kind of stuff. So ruthinstitute.org is how you find us. We also have an active Facebook page and a very active YouTube channel. channel. So that's where you can connect with us.
Okay, before we let you go, Dr. Morse, we like to ask our guests for advice for especially our young listeners, because when Sarah and I started this podcast, we had our daughters in mind of women that we wanted them to know were out there and were doing things that we wanted our daughters to look up to. So when you think about the high school, college girl of today, what advice would you give her?
So what I would say to the high school, college age young people, stick close to your mom and dad if you possibly can, okay? And when you go off to college, there will be a lot of people trying to separate you from your parents. And I would really encourage you to be very, very discerning about that. They're going to tell you things that are going to sound good. They're going to sound attractive. They'll tell you things that will build up your ego in some ways. They'll tell you things that will make you think your mom and dad are bad. I would say just be very, very cautious about that. And come back home and talk to your parents. And if you feel like you're smarter than your parents, which will happen for some of you, you'll get that feeling that you're more educated than your parents. And so therefore, they don't understand, they don't get it, and so on and so forth. Look for somebody in the community that shares your parents' values, but whom you do see as being educated as you feel that you now are, or that you aspire to be. That's what I would say to you. Don't be just chasing bright, shiny objects, because I promise you, when you go to college, even sadly, some Christian colleges, you're going to have lots and lots of temptations to get involved in the sexual revolution. And once you start taking those actions, your moral frame of reference gets all shifted around, because now you may feel some guilt. And you may have some visceral feeling that it's wrong, but then you're being told that it's really okay and you should get rid of those feelings of guilt, that the guilty feeling is the only problem. And so there'll be a lot of confusion, but your moral grounding will kind of get shifted. And so it's important that you stay as solid as you possibly can. And if you do something wrong, and if you feel that this isn't right, the thing to do is not to redefine your morals. The thing to do is to make amends and try to backtrack it on whatever you've done. And there'll be lots of pressure for you to not do that, but to go the whole hog of the sexual revolution. So that'd be how I would caution that age group of person, to just tell them realistically you're going to encounter it. And in some cases, I've had people ask me this all the time, where would you send your kid to school, blah, blah, blah. In some cases, you're better off going to a big state secular university that has a good campus ministry program rather than a school which is Catholic or Christian in name only, because those Catholic and Christian in name only institutions are much more subversive. You know, they're going to weasel with you a little bit more, you know. So, you know, go to Texas A&M or something and be part of a big, solid campus ministry program. You'll be better off there.
Yeah, that's great advice. Okay, next question. Are you a one book at a time kind of person, or do you have several? Okay,
so what are you? No stinking way. No stinking way. I can't read one book at a time.
What are you reading right now? Can you tell us?
Well, I mean, I'm always reading some more than one thing at a time. So I just finished a book by Carl Truman called The Rise and Triumph of the Modern Self, Cultural Amnesia, Expressive Individualism, and the Road to Sexual Revolution. It's a really good book.
And what a title.
It's a good book. Now, this is a guy who writes for First Things a lot of the time, and I'm going to interview him on my program pretty soon. I'm also reading a book called The Writings of St. Maximilian Kolbe. He is a priest who was murdered at Auschwitz, and he had a newspaper magazine that he ran for years and years before he was arrested and stuff. So I'm reading his stuff. And then I'm reading a book by Robert Riley called America on Trial, A Defense of the Founding. So that's what I'm reading right now. And then I'm rereading. I'm always rereading stuff too. I'm rereading a collection of essays from First Things magazine in 1997. Chuck Colson was involved in it. It was called The End of Democracy. And it was this whole symposium on whether judicial activism meant that we had lost our democracy. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? And then the other book I want to mention that I had occasion to reread, it's by a woman who has a doctorate in philosophy. Her name is Carrie Gress. She also has 5 children. And the book is called The Anti-Mary Exposed, Rescuing the Culture from Toxic Femininity. And so her idea is that you've got Antichrist, and we're all familiar with the concept of Antichrist. So she's going anti-Mary. Her idea basically is that feminism takes every trait normally associated with the Virgin Mary and opposes it. So whether it's her purity and chastity, whether it's her humility, her obedience to the will of God, her embrace of mother, everything that she is, feminism is the opposite. So that's what this book does, is to, you know, so it's a, in a way, a defense of femininity standing on its head.
Yeah.
You know, I think your listeners would be blessed by it, really.
Okay.
And I think you would be blessed by it. So yeah, I'm rereading Carrie's book.
Well, okay, our last question is, Dr. Morse, if you could choose any woman in history to sit and have coffee with, who would you like to do that with?
Well, so first of all, I don't drink coffee.
But, okay,
so
you could have tea. You could have, do you like tea?
I know, I'm messing with you.
How could you not like coffee?
This is not the spirit of the question here. I know, I really fouled this up.
What drink would you choose if you had an afternoon to drink something? I'm just kidding.
So actually that's very easy for me. It would be Mary. You know, I would want it. And I would love to talk with the Mother of God. That would be great. That would be so great. I would ask her, what was he like when he was a little boy? Tell us some more baby stories. We only have like two or three stories. What the heck? What was wrong with Luke? What's just those stories, man? What was he like when he was a little boy?
Yeah.
Well, Mary has been a popular choice for sure.
Is that so?
All of our guests. So we will all be eager to hear from her for sure.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Morse, for spending time with us, for the insights you brought. And I'm excited for our listeners to hear this. And I'm sure it will bring up some questions. And I hope it'll bring some interest to Ruth Institute, too. And we appreciate the work you do for the family and for the victims of the sexual revolution and just all the work that you've done with the Ruth Institute. So thanks for joining us.
You're very welcome. It's been my pleasure. Thanks, girls.
You've been listening to Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, interviewed on the show Strong Women Podcast. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for stable families and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcast can be found online at ruthinstitute.org/podcasts. Again, that is ruthinstitute.org/podcasts. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with your friends, like us on Facebook, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.